greatest shot ever given to professional wrestling. That man did right there.
Let's get everybody out of the dressing room right now and kick his rear end.
Unbelievable, brother.
What have I been saying all these years? What have I been saying all these years?
Oh, my God.
A career of a lifetime.
It's
right down the drain, kid.
Do it, Sean.
Hello, everyone, and welcome to the show. I am OJ, and with me is the man who invented Bluetooth when he stole Gargamel's dinner, John Rambo.
What? What was that? Man, you pulled that out of somewhere. I don't even understand it, really. I like
Gargamel
it, though, John.
Wants to keep the Smurfs, they're using them to make gold.
I like your style, John. I like the way you move, sir. I like your moves. You got good moves. What can I say?
Like when I hit you with the chair?
Yeah, what was that about? A little violent there. And perhaps some things to come? I hope not.
No, I would not. I would not do that to you,
sir. You hit
me
with a chair. You know what I hit with you back with? Whatever,
yeah,
I'm struck with.
We can't share that on the show.
Yeah, there you go.
It's not appropriate.
Yeah, it actually kind of fits what I was about to say. Whatever someone hits me with, I hit them with something 10 times the strength and power of that item that they hit me with, which always turns out to be one thing, miraculously. I know it's kind of weird. So those nice intros made by Mr. Mike Vida. And you can find him at youtube.com/livethevida, LiveTheVida. And I added some little music there, and you know, some copyrighted music, sprinkle it over it. Copyrighted music adds a little spice and a niceness to everything that you added to, doesn't it?
Oh,
agree with
my
that?
Gosh. Seriously.
So, we got a nice show today.
Oh,
I'm
I think so.
Excited about it. Is everything working correctly? We were having some problems before we got on.
Yeah, we had a bunch of issues.
We're okay now? Everyone's saying it's good? All right. So, John, I'm sure you're aware of this. We have a very special visitor today.
Mm-hmm.
In about an hour, at the 9 o'clock hour, the great Mr. Ed Trotta will be with us once again. He's part of the family. He's doing his monthly visit, and we got a lot of cool stuff with him to talk about.
Mm-hmm.
And all of that. We got some other stuff. Me and OJ went to the woods. And I got some video in play. We're going to talk about that as well.
Oh, baby.
Kind of explain what we were doing out there.
Oh, went into the woods, not got some. Okay, I get it now.
What? What the? But as we start, I want to talk about something that happened recently. We want to dedicate today's broadcast to everyone in the great city of Boston and all the beautiful people that live there. And I know many of you guys are from Boston that watch our stuff. We've been lucky to, you know, meet many of you and talk to many of you. Slinky, who's a staple of the show, he's on many times. Booma, among others. And I hope you know everyone up there. You guys are all safe, and your city and everyone affected by this will recover soon. And OJ, yeah. I know you have a lot of history in that area. That's
yeah,
your area.
My dad's side of the family.
And you go up to Boston quite a bit, and you love Boston.
Mm-hmm.
Is that your favorite place? One of your favorite places?
One of them.
It's one of your favorite cities.
Yeah, they've got some really cool stuff there.
They certainly deserve better than...
Way better.
They received.
It's abominable.
Yes. But I'm going to go on a little bit of a rant about it. I'm going to talk a little bit about just things in general. And I want to thank everyone on this planet that's strong enough and brave enough and capable enough to live life, OJ. Because life can be difficult.
Yeah.
Life is challenging. It's tough at times. And life can flat out suck. Trust me, I know. But there's people out there that can handle it. We do our best to handle it. It's what we do. You know, human beings get up at the crack of dawn and go to work, right?
Every day.
Or maybe every day, or we work all night, or all different times, and do jobs many times they don't even like their job. But we do what we have to do to provide for ourselves and people
and
we care about and our families. And this is what we need to do, and we do it. And then there's those of us that take on huge financial debt and invest years of their life to attend school to hopefully better themselves and become educated, right?
Mm-hmm.
And perhaps learn something, learn a trade, so you can go out in society and give to society.
Mm-hmm.
And a lot of people go to work and school, John.
Oh, at the same time.
At the same time.
Boy.
We've done it. And people do all this on top of paying bills, going to doing grocery shopping, the laundry, and the plethora of crap that life will give to you every day.
Mm-hmm.
And maybe you get an hour or two a day to yourself. OJ, what's your daily weekday like? How many hours a day do you get to yourself after all the stuff you're responsible to do?
Day hours by myself?
What kind of, yeah, just free time, like a work day.
Yeah,
2 hours, an hour?
An hour, two at most, usually, unless it's a Thursday.
I think that's pretty common for most people. Right? But, you know, life is a lot of sacrifice. And people do what they have to do, though, because we know it's best for ourselves, it's best for all of us. Right? And then sometimes things don't work out. Sometimes things go wrong. But you try again. And people that do what they need to do, people that live their life, deserve all the great things the world has to offer. And if you do these things, you're on the right track to getting those things, right?
Yeah, you just have to keep moving on down.
You got to keep moving on. Doing the best you can, that's all you can do. But unfortunately, we have to live, and we have to share this planet with those that basically gave up. People that failed at life. Somewhere along the line, you know, these people, things got difficult, and it broke them. Instead of acting like adults, we talk about we need to act like adults on this program. Instead of acting like adults, figuring out their problems or seeking out help for their problems or doing things that may improve their life, they get angry, they get pissed off, and then they put all their effort into hurting people. Not mm-hmm. just themselves. It's one thing to hurt yourself. It's a terrible thing to do that. A lot of people do that. That's one thing. When you start hurting other people, you know, that's when it gets really quite disgusting.
That's well past crossing the line.
And these folks are out there. All right. So, my friends, what can we do about this situation? You know, we got the FBI, you got the cops, and all these other groups are out there. They're trying to hunt these people down, putting cameras everywhere, doing this and that. But what can we do? What can the common person do, right? And you know, it may sound simple, and it may sound maybe stupid to you, but what we always like to say is we try to simplify things, right?
Mm-hmm. That's kind of what we do around here.
We try to simplify the problems.
Very simple.
And what I feel about this, I think we all need to make sure we're living our lives the way we live our life. We live as a positive force in the world. You know, it's like the little things that matter. You know, day by day we meet people, right? You meet people, you run into people at the store, walking by, whatever.
Mm-hmm.
You have interactions with people. You know, when you meet somebody or talk to someone, no matter what it is, you know, be nice to them and respectful to them, right?
Yes.
Little things. I'm not saying, like, run up to people and start fondling them or groping or anything like that.
No, that's well past the line.
Just be cool to people when you meet people.
Mm-hmm.
You're like, 'cause even if it's a little interaction, you don't know what that person's going through in their life, what they're experiencing. And sometimes all a person needs is a little bit of kindness.
You just want to brighten their day from having been in it, even if it's just for a minute, you know?
Do you agree with this?
Yeah, you want to either leave them how they were or a little bit better.
Right.
You don't have to do anything more than that. If everyone did that,
yeah,
it would be amazing.
And some people are dicks to you first, I understand that. But stay away from those people, you know?
Yeah.
And if you have interaction with them, be polite to them. Because that'll make them feel worse about how they're acting. They'll be like, why am I such a dick to that guy when he's nice to me? You know?
I mean, at the very least, maybe you can get some... If enough people are nice to a jerk, maybe they'll suddenly realize what they're doing wrong.
Perhaps, but maybe not. But, you know, you got to try things. You know, if someone around you, like neighbor, coworker, somebody needs help with something, classmate needs help, you know, try to help them out. I understand we all got 1,000 things going on. But, you know, maybe you try to help somebody out, they'll appreciate it. Maybe not, but again, you try. You got to try.
You
got to do what you can. You got to try to put some good vibes out there in the world. You know.
Hopefully, if enough little changes amongst people's attitudes can really bring about more than you would think.
I think so. Just little steps here and there. And, you know, will this actually stop someone from doing a shooting or blowing something up? Probably not directly, but I think it's about changing attitudes and helping people realize, you know, we're all in this together. We're all neighbors. We're all living the same. This is the same planet. We're all neighbors in the planet. And, you know, everyone that lives here, you know, if everyone knows that they're cared about and that there's other people that will help them if they're going through a problem, you know, and that they're not alone in the world. If you get that message across, I think you can change the world. If that's the case, if everyone feels that way, right?
I think you're right.
And the world's a beautiful place, and instead of having this stuff go on, we should all be enjoying this place together.
I think part of the problem is just getting people to realize, you know, to just take another look at what's around them and realize, you know, there's a lot of bad stuff going down, but there's a lot of good stuff, you know, going on too, and you can't let the bad stuff wash it all out and get you down. It's hard. It's harder than it sounds, but still.
Right. Exactly. Mm. So, my friends, let's keep moving forward. And most people are doing the good things, like OJ said, right?
I should hope so.
Yes. Anything else to say about this?
I don't know. I've just been kind of quiet about this whole thing.
Okay.
Yeah.
Well, we're talking about the world's a beautiful place. And me and OJ, from time to time, we like to go together, and we have these little days together, and we try to enjoy the world together. A lot of togetherness, you and I. So this past weekend, we went out into the woods alone.
And we made it back.
There was no one else there.
We made it back somehow.
Do you want to explain what we were doing so it doesn't sound as bizarre as I'm making it sound?
We went to the woods, and we walked back there alone. And we didn't see anyone, and we found some destroyed wooden things and trees.
You're doing a terrible
but
job.
No bees.
So basically, we're trying to find a location to film at, and we're looking at different places. So we went to this big, it was like a nature center. What is this?
The Stanford Museum and Nature Center.
I thought it was kind of weird because it's kind of like a nature reserve or something. Mm-hmm. But what it is, it's basically like a bunch of woods. We have to pay money to go into the woods.
Well, there's a lot of other stuff besides the woods, but it's the easiest woods to find that I know I can go to.
It's like to pay money to go into the woods is kind of a weird idea, but this is where we're at. You know, they took down a lot of the trees and stuff. So that if there's only one patch of woods left, you could charge people to go into the woods.
Yeah, pretty
much.
But
anyway, but the money goes towards maintaining the land, right? It's not like a guy makes money off it. Right?
Yeah, sorry. The image in this dream right now is an Albert Einstein Green Lantern.
That goes back from like 100 shows ago. Remember the Green
Lantern? I know. I haven't seen it in a while. Lose my mind.
So we go to the woods. We're walking around in the woods, and it was pretty nice. There's like a stream.
Beautiful.
There's trees.
Well, lots of trees, lots of streams, lots of bridges, rivers.
You were there, John. You remember this? That this happened?
What?
That we forget it.
That we were in the woods?
So then there's also a farm, and we go to the farm.
Oh, yes. I didn't know if you wanted me to bring up the farm or not.
Yeah, I'm going to play some video from the farm.
It was a lovely farm.
So there's a farm like at the end of these woods. I'm started walking around this farm, and it was pretty fun. Right? There's different animals there.
A lot of animals. Some looked to be a lot happier than others, though.
Some were like on their deathbeds.
Yeah, I did notice that the beehives were covered with stones, so I hope the bees are still sleeping by the time we need to go there.
And we're walking around, there's all these different animals, and people, you know, there's people there, and they're going, oh, it's so beautiful.
It was a four-year-old's birthday party.
Yeah, it was a birthday party, yeah, people were having a good time, and then OJ just turns to me and he's like, this is making me hungry.
Okay,
I
look.
Go, what are you talking about? He goes, all these animals, they make me hungry. So he wanted to eat the animals, basically.
That's also, there was a four-year-old's birthday party with people eating at a picnic table directly to my right, which is what I first saw.
I didn't
when
notice
I
that.
Hungry.
You're just looking at goats, and he goes, "Oh wow, I would like to. I feel hungry."
Hey, goat curry is really good.
That's you know. This reminds me of I went to the aquarium. I talked about this a couple weeks ago,
mm-hmm.
And the strangest display I ever saw in my life. They had like a fish tank. They had a tank. That makes sense at the aquarium, right? So they had a tank. And they had the fish in it. The next to the tank was like the food that's like rubber. What is it? Wax or something? It's like wax food.
Wax food. Yeah.
Wax food, and it shows.
Oh,
the,
yeah.
It shows the dish that you could make from the fish that you're looking at next to the tank. Imagine that fish knew what was happening here. Isn't that kind of a weird display, though?
Yeah,
like here's what it looks like alive. Here's what it looks like when you get it on the dish. Like, do you really need to see that?
I think they're trying. Are they trying to dissuade people from eating the fish?
No, they were just showing like these are the types of fish that you eat.
Huh.
It wasn't supposed to be like anti anything. It was just kind of like showing you the fish in case you wanted to know what did it look like first.
Well, I mean,
then
it's
you look
fish.
Like it. Then you see what it looks like on the dish, and then you see it later when it comes out of you. All the forms. It's like a Pokemon. Transforms. But anyway.
Wait, are you saying that salmon evolved into dinner?
Exactly, yes. Yes. So anyway, we took some video at the farm. A lot of it wasn't very good. Some of it's pretty funny. I don't know. Maybe OJ wants to upload it or something to his channel maybe one day. I don't know. You can mess with it if you want.
Okay.
I didn't really look through it. But there's one clip I want to show. And racism does exist in this world, right? Do you agree with me? I think so. Unfortunately.
Yeah, it's really sad.
But I didn't think of between animals that they felt that way.
Yeah, you'd think that they all just got along. I mean, they have plenty of food, plenty of water, a decent amount of space for their size. I knew
racism existed with humans, and it's disgusting, terrible. But never in my wildest dreams did I believe that animals would be racist until this day, and we found out that they, in fact, are racists. So I'm going to play this video for you now. It's about 2 minutes long. OJ, if you don't mind muting the microphone, which he seems very upset about doing for some reason. It's a bother for him to do this. It's a big bother that he's got to push a button, ladies and gentlemen. This is what I have to deal with on a daily basis with this guy. But anyway, here is the video. Well, I don't know what he's saying. What's going on here? Are they fighting or having sex? And is there a difference in the goat world? What are they doing? Should we stop? John, break this up. John, break this up, dude. Get in there. Get in there, stop this madness. Well, he's ramming his antlers into the wood. And this other one's like, what are you thinking? Am I supposed to do that? Is he scratching him? Like, he's just trying to, like, he's got an itch? Oh my god.
Stuck?
Hey, st-
I can't tell if they're not, if they like each other or not.
They're trying to figure it out. Their relationship is hard to define. Whoa!
Bill Sebastian.
Oh, he came over. Look at this. He came over. He was pissed. And then these two just like, we don't like each other, but we're goats. And we will unite against the miniature horse. John, he's gonna bite you, John. Elliot, they're very cautious looking at the miniature horse. So, like, I'm in a part of that guy. He's not one of us. This guy's gonna go tell him right now. Look at this. He's gonna go tell him. Tell him off. See that? Look at that. Strength in numbers, guys. Don't be afraid of him. Standoff. We got OJ and the miniature horse versus the two goats. Alright, well, the horse is gone. They're going back to what they were doing before, which is this one rams his head against the wood, and the other one just kind of hangs out and watches. Still there? John, you still there?
Yes.
All right. So, what do you think was going on there? That was kind of an interesting scene.
Like, yeah.
What is that thing? It's not a horse. It's not a, what is it? A donkey? I don't even know what that is.
It's actually it's a miniature donkey.
Is that the Dominic the Italian Christmas donkey? Is that what that was about?
It very well could be. It very well could be Dominic the Italian Christmas donkey.
So the two, those are goats. Where are those things?
I don't know what the goats were. They're some sort of goat. The
some
other
sort
ones
of
were,
goat. They're hanging out. One's ramming his head against the wall. And then the thing peeks around the corner. They freak out.
Yeah, just like nope.
And then they're like, all right, let's go talk to him. They start the both of them, and then he just bolts out too.
Little Sebastian.
So I got a bunch of videos like that. Maybe John will take them. I don't know. Whatever. Yeah, what were you wearing during that? It was kind of a weird outfit.
Yeah, it was a black shirt, black pants, and a yellow belt.
Yeah, yeah.
Very classy, very classy. Yeah. It's my yellow jacket costume.
So I had a good time at the farm with you. Did you enjoy that I was there?
Yeah, the farm was a lot of fun. I just wish the otters weren't asleep when we were there.
Oh, just a big otter guy.
Mm-hmm, they're super cute. The little otter teeth and...
I think we may actually film there, but I don't know if we might get in trouble, but... You know, what else is new?
Look, if we just walk back there with, like, everyone just wearing their clothing and we just have bags, they'll think we're going for a picnic and we're all dressed in uniforms or something.
They're going to think it's some kind of weird thing with the goats and the horse and some kind of weird guy with latex gloves and some kind of weird sex thing. I don't know.
Well, that's after we finish filming.
Yes, yes, yes. But anyway, I think maybe we'll do something with that. This last week we went back to the location that we got kicked out of previously, and we were able to finish what we needed to do there.
Just took a second.
We had to be like real ninja about it. Like we would wait out in the car, and then wait till like people were gonna run out and do it, and then run back.
Mm-hmm.
And it was a good time.
Elite.
One thing I want to bring up, I'm excited about. We got a new microphone.
Yeah.
And we were able to get the microphone because all you guys, for some reason, I don't know why this is, but like the last 2 weeks, like the shirt sales went crazy. I don't know, maybe it's because like the weather's better. People are like, I want like a short sleeve shirt or something. I don't really know what happened. That's the only thing I could come up with. It can't be that we're doing good stuff here because that'd be a ridiculous idea, especially since we got OJ over here. I mean, that's, you know. But anyway, the last like 2 weeks we sold so many shirts, we were able to use the money to get an awesome microphone. And what was it, like $150 or something? It was a lot.
Yeah, it was many monies.
And it's a shotgun mic. Do you have it near you? Would you show everybody what they got us?
No, it's in the other room.
All right, well, they don't need to see that. How's it look? I didn't get to see it yet.
It looks good. It looks like the old mic, but it has a really fuzzy gray fuzzy cover to block out wind fuzzy.
I wish you had it with you, but don't get it now. Don't worry about it. So I want to, you know, thank everybody that, you know, contributed and stuff, and now we got a nice microphone. Because our sound kind of sucks. Like, it's okay. So basically some of the scenes will sound like the previous episodes, and then some of the scenes will sound really good.
Yeah.
Oh, well. Do the best we can.
This
is what we talked about earlier. Do the best you can, you know?
Mm-hmm.
So I was talking about we went to the farm and I filmed a bunch of animals.
Walk and, with the animals.
The next day, I filmed a whole different group of animals because I had a big family party, which I did some filming at.
You recorded at the family party?
Yeah, aww. Well, yeah, it didn't really come out well. Nice. But my grandmother turned 80 years old on Sunday.
Nice.
And we had a party at a restaurant.
Aww.
And that was like a surprise party. And then we all got surprised because my sister lives in Vegas and my uncle lives in San Francisco, L.A. Yeah, L.A.
That's pretty far.
So they weren't supposed to come, right? And all of a sudden they just showed up.
What, they walk?
They flew in and they stayed at a hotel secretly and no one knew. And then they came to the party and, you know, I was kind of upset because my entrance is always supposed to be a grand entrance. And they showed up and then they kind of stole the thunder there, but that was a good time, you know. I mean, 80. I mean, that's pretty up there.
You say 80 or 90?
80.
Wow, that is pretty old.
Seen a lot of things.
Yeah.
What kind of thing, when you're 80 years old, what kind of things do you think you'll have seen?
Well, so several things that I can't mention here, but no, think about it, John. Think about the sort of technology we're going to see. I mean, we're going to go from Google Glass to who knows what the frell. We're going to be seeing out there like
Google socks.
You know, I'm waiting for the day when they have GPS tracking socks. I mean, they could make them now. There's just no use for them. But it will happen.
Because you know about this stuff. This is kind of like your industry.
No,
right?
Well, you know why, right? No, here's the thing. You need the GPS mounted socks because you always lose one.
So
you'll know where it is at all times. See? So you got, these are the things you got to think about. Like, where is technology going to go? Okay, we found our missing socks. What's next on the agenda? What is a big annoyance for us? I don't know. You solve the sock problem. I'm pretty content. Yeah. I mean, what else?
That's the biggest thing you got to worry about right now.
What else can technology do for us nowadays? think about it. We've got giant, tiny, we've got gigantic TVs that are like an inch in profile.
Yeah.
We are seeing stuff on our TVs at higher frame rates than we can watch normally.
Yeah, whoever, who's the one that was complaining about HD that we need Ultra HD? Who's the guy complaining that, oh, this is not 1080p, this is not enough for me?
Yeah, I mean, I saw the, what is it, the 4K TV at the Sony store in Vegas.
Yeah, we talked about that last week.
Yeah, we did. I mean, okay, it's like the Wii U. It's solving a problem we don't have. Is it nice? Yes.
Yeah, well, I guess the real problem is they need to keep selling you things.
Yeah, I mean,
it's not our problem, it's their problem.
Well, let's talk about technology for a brief second.
Sure, OJ. You take control of this, and you tell me what to do. Go ahead.
Well, ABK Freeman just mentioned... I read it wrong. Sorry, someone said something about me getting a new phone. I completely scrolled away and lost it.
Yeah.
Because, yeah, I need a new phone already. That's a technological... what's ABK Freeman? It will get you a new phone, OJ. Yeah, because technology, I think I need a new phone already. Because my original phone broke, right?
Yeah, yeah.
You know, it just stopped working. It just turned itself off and then wouldn't turn on again.
Mm-hmm.
And then I got it replaced. And my new phone, over the past month and a half, the SIM card has been failing. So it'll say, oh, sorry, you can make an emergency call if your carrier allows it, but your SIM card's not working, ha-ha.
You've already been through this. It's a self-fulfilling prophecy. You got the worst possible phone you could get, so you could complain.
Yeah. I went to the phone company store, and they got me a new SIM card, no problem. The next day, SIM card breaks again.
Yeah.
And then today, the phone's in my shirt pocket. Here, there's no way for me to hit the power button, which is on top. I reached to check to see what time it is. Power's off. I turn it on. Oh, okay, phone's back on. That's a little worrisome. I'm eating dinner. I go back to it. The phone's off again.
You gotta
battery,
get a better phone. 49%. You get a better phone. I don't know what to tell you.
Yeah.
This isn't the complain about, you know, consumer, Microsoft consumer talk to person thing.
I'm just telling you that
I'm not
a
work for them. I can't. I'm not the guy on the other end that can fix your problem. I don't work for them. I could talk you through it. I would tell you the wrong things. I would tell you to remove the screen, pour some gelatin in the middle of it, and then I would laugh that you broke your phone. I don't know.
Gelatin?
What are you drinking?
What?
What are you drinking there? Ovaltine? What is this?
Totally water.
All right, here we go. One thing that you stuck in your mouth this last weekend. You, sir, had a Juicy Lucy from our favorite place at Stanford. Called Lucky's. Tell everyone what a Juicy Lucy is.
A Juicy Lucy is a cheeseburger where the cheese is on the inside of the burger. It is not on the outside, although it could also be on the outside.
Mm-hmm.
You take a nice big, at least a 12-ounce patty, at least in this case, and you stuff it full of cheese, and you cook that big patty up, serve it with some crispy onions on top,
apparently
a side of fries that comes with it.
Apparently you're in Southern Alabama.
I don't know what happened.
But, you ever see the show Man vs. Food? I was telling you about this.
Yeah, you were telling me
about it. The show Man vs. Food. I used to watch the show. I liked the show. And this dude, he goes to different places all across the country, and he shows these unique burgers, and mostly like barbecue and that type of food, right? And one of the places he went to, I can't remember what it was, the Juicy Lucy was like the staple of this restaurant.
Mm-hmm.
Then after the show came out, like everyone started making this burger. They all ripped it off, and they call it the same thing. And we went to the place. We're like, oh my god, they have the Juicy Lucy. We ordered it.
Yeah.
And the waiter's like, oh, that's my signature dish. Like, I came up with that. You're really gonna like it. I'm like, no, you didn't. You liar. The guy lied. He tried to say that he created it, but he didn't.
But that's a server we get like all the time. So I don't think we should badmouth him.
He doesn't listen to this program. not many people do. So don't worry about that.
Especially
in the food industry, they won't touch this program. They hate it.
So we had a slight problem. Because usually you go to this burger store and you order a burger, and the burger comes by itself. If you want fries or something, you order it separately. So we each got a Juicy Lucy, and normally we order a thing of fries and rings, which is effing huge. And, you know, put that between us, we're good. Guy comes out, and there's three plates. I'm like, what the what? There's the burger, and next to the burger on each plate is a heaping pile of French fries. And in the middle is the half fries, half rings that we asked for.
Yeah. Did you eat those yet?
No.
It's like a vote. John, just think about our day, what this sounds like to people, okay? Got to OJ's house early in the morning. We both put on costumes, walked around in the woods, together, alone, with no one else. Then afterwards, We went to a restaurant and ordered the same food. You both ordered the same dish. And then we went back to the house.
Although, to be fair,
just think about what that sounds like. Yeah.
One nice thing about getting the half fries, half rings, and the fries was that my fries were like soggy, mm-hmm. but the ones in the center plate were good.
I like how you come alive when we're talking about the food.
I could go to death when talking about food. I could tell you about what I ate Friday
before
night.
Before this, she's all quiet, and then all of a sudden, I was like, "Oh, here I am, shining brighter than ever, talking about French fries."
Well, you want to know what happened on Saturday
night?
All right,
do it quick. So I got to talk about injustice. We got to go with comments. We got to end.
Okay, quick. Yeah. As long as we're talking about food, I met up with some friends of mine I hadn't seen in a while. And we went and played some card games, blah, blah, blah. And then it was time for everyone to go home. And one of my friends was going to drive because they got their driver's license and they're making up for all the times that we had to drive them all around. So they're like, "Oh, I'll drive everybody home." And then somebody goes, 4 a.m. pancakes. 4 a.m. pancakes! Meanwhile, it's like midnight.
This is after you had the Juicy Lucy, by the way.
Yeah. And,
but you're going to blame the pancakes, even though it had nothing to do with that.
I'm like, "Fine, you know what? I haven't seen you guys in a while. Let's go to the diner. Let's get the pancakes. Booyah." And then the person who's driving drives me to my house instead. And I'm like, "Oh, okay. I guess I'm not getting pancakes. Well, we're here. I'll go to bed. I'm pretty tired. Have a good night." And then someone's like, "I thought you were getting pancakes. No, stop the car. Start the car. Don't let him out." And then they start driving away, and I'm basically kidnapped to pancakes, where I order one of those. You know, if you go to breakfast places, they have those giant combos. I can't ever just order pancakes. Yeah, I ended up with a pretty wicked stomach ache the next day. And that's my bridge story. Chocolate chip pancakes.
Well, I'm glad you told it. We learned a lot. I certainly learned quite a bit.
Don't eat a short stack of chocolate chip pancakes with 2 eggs, 2 bacon, and home fries and 2 sausage late at night with hot chocolate.
After Juicy Lucy about 2 hours before that.
No, that was like a long time before. Yeah, I didn't even see them till like 10 p.m.
Okay, well, it's
ridiculous.
It was 4 hours before that.
Yarf.
Do you want to talk about your little celebration thing? Or
all right.
So you want me to talk about it or what? You want to just go for it?
Okay.
Ladies and gentlemen, OJ, was it Monday? OJ
Sunday.
Had his Sunday, I'm sorry.
Well, Sunday was the day, but we celebrated Monday.
All right, well, anyway, to prove that me and OJ walking through the woods and eating together and all that has nothing to do with anything, it's just friends, OJ celebrated his 6-month anniversary with his lovely girlfriend. And OJ decided, "I'm going to have a big bash. I'm gonna just knock her socks off." Talking a lot about socks today. It's a sock. Maybe that's the title of the show today, socks. And OJ did something that he planned. What went on? Tell us.
All right. Well,
for the anniversary.
Well, a few. Like,
first
a few
of all,
weeks
what did you dress as? James Bond? What did you wear? Did you dress nice?
Did I dress? Yeah, I dressed nice.
Did you bring like a present? A flower?
I had presents.
You had multiple presents.
Yeah, but I didn't bring them with me. I left them at my house.
Was this a surprise, or did she know this was all going on?
Well, she knew we were going somewhere, and she figured out where we were going. Because basically, we were walking past this particular restaurant a few weeks prior when we went to go see Kevin. And she said, "Oh, man, the Russian Tea Room. I'd love to go there at some point." And I wrote that down in my phone. Hopefully she doesn't listen to this and realize that when she says things, I sometimes write them down.
Because you're paying attention. That's good.
Yeah. So I remember this place. And then the next day she says, "Yeah, you know, our anniversary's coming up soon. You know, it's been 6 months since we started dating. I don't know. You want to get a nice dinner?" I'm like, "Okay, I can put 2 and 12 together. I can see what's going on here."
Yeah.
So I go to the restaurant's website, start poking around at it, look at the food. I'm like, "Yeah, I can eat this." And use their website to make reservations. And then she says, "I make them for 8 o'clock just in case, because, you know, I might get out of work late or something stupid like that, and you don't want to risk it." And so we get closer. She says, "You know what? Let's meet at a bar or something first, and then walk over," because I still never told her where we were going. So I picked a bar right by the train station. And I end up getting like the early train. I left work right on time. I walked to the train station. I made the train. It was awesome.
You forgot all the presents at home, you said?
Yeah, I didn't want to carry a lot of stuff.
Oh, so was it, you didn't like forget them. It was just, that was the plan.
No, they were at home.
Okay.
And I realize, oh gosh, I'm going to get here really early. And then she sends me a text message saying, I got here really early. I'm at the bar.
She's
like, okay. And then I leave the trains to the subway and walk right past the bar and keep going because I didn't know where it was. Like, it was right next to the other exit
the place
from
that
the subway.
You made reservations there. You made reservations and everything. And then
this was just for the bar first. So,
reservations
are for 8 o'clock, and this is like 6:50.
Oh, this is complicated. Well, why don't you tell everyone where you guys went?
Yeah, well,
what's the place you picked? Tell us.
Well, it was the Russian Tea Room.
The Russian Tea Room in New York, that's a famous place, right?
I hope so. I think so.
Is there like a dress code in there? What's going on in there?
Dress code is business casual. But I went in dress slacks, collared shirt with a tie and a sport coat.
They let you go in there with that hair? That was okay?
Yeah.
So
it was fine.
What does it look like in there? People, snooty. Give us a taste of the scene. Of the
okay,
action.
So we walk to the front, and there's a bar where nobody's sitting.
Right.
And
it's
the area,
show.
And there's a very big red theme. Like, all the tables and chairs are red. Everything is, there's a lot of red. The walls are nice gold color. The ceiling is gold leaf or actual gold. And there's paintings all along the walls, from famous painters, all sorts of stuff. A lot of the stuff is obviously based on Russia, because the restaurant, I think, started when people fled the Russian Revolution and came here.
They opened a high-priced restaurant.
Then it was just a tea room.
We will flee this communist society. We will open a restaurant where everyone must wear business casual, and it's $75 for a soda. We have done
I didn't
it.
Even check to see
the
how much
American
soda
dream.
Been.
So, what was his menu like? What are we talking price-wise?
Well, first of all, here's the funny thing. We get there, and we have a booth, right? And the booth is shaped like a really fat letter U.
Yeah.
So, it's kind of like that. Like, yeah.
Okay, yeah, I know what you're doing. I've seen that before.
Yeah. That just looks odd. Anyway.
What?
So, we get there, and both dishes are on the same side.
What does that mean?
Of the table.
Well, these are on the table. Were they on the floor? I mean,
the dishes are on. Normally when you sit across from somebody when there's two of you?
Yeah.
They seated us next to each other facing the other side of the room.
Okay,
and they pulled the table out every time we had to stand up or sit down.
So you're like, you're getting up. I go to the bathroom. They'll come out like people run over and pull the table out?
Yes.
That's kind of bizarre.
And I deliberately drank 20 glasses of water beforehand.
No, let me ask you this. Every time you used like a fork and you put it down, did they run over with a new one? Because I went somewhere the one time it was like that. I went to Bobby Flay's restaurant in New York City.
Bar Americaine?
I forget what it's called. I don't remember.
Okay.
But you would like use, you would have like, say you had like a salad with your dinner. You would use the utensils. They'd come over, take everything away. The napkin, the forks, the knife, everything would go. And they would come bring new ones for like each course.
They took.
This is kind of a waste. This is a waste of time here.
I think it went through 3 or 4 forks, two or three knives, one spoon, and I believe just the one napkin, one teacup, one cocktail glass, one water glass, and one between the two of us, 10 plates.
This is great audio, John. You were thinking of empty plates.
Anyway, but the food, this was kind of, we basically decided to do what, if you're going to go to a fancy restaurant, we decided to go all out. So we ordered like the snootiest food imaginable that
What'd
we could think of.
What'd you get?
So appetizers, we ordered escargot and frog legs.
You like that? You like the frog legs? I didn't know you liked that.
I'd never had them before.
Was it like the Juicy Lucy? There's cheese inside?
No, they're like way better than jellyfish, let me tell you. So escargot tastes like eggs to me. It tastes like eggs. I don't know how else to describe it.
I thought it was eggs.
No, it's snails, bro.
Oh, okay. I'm thinking of caviar.
Yeah, I'm sorry. Effing snails. Ugh. Weird concept, but it was surprisingly tasty. And then we ordered frog legs, and dude brought out foie gras instead.
What is that?
Like,
Is that a racist word?
It's basically you feed a duck until it's super fat and engorged, and then kill it and eat its liver.
Yeah.
As a pate, which was kind of not great. But the thing was, we ordered frog legs, and we're like, this doesn't look like frog legs. It looks like a slab of something. So...
how much can you give us a price point? Is that too much information?
You could just go to the website. I mean, if you just go to the website, you'll see how much the stuff
was. Just tell us that.
Yeah, it's a lot.
It's quite a bit.
Yeah.
Is it the most you ever spend on a dinner?
Yeah.
For food?
Yeah.
It was more than the pancakes that you ate in the middle of the night for no reason?
Yeah.
It was a lot more than that?
Yeah.
What did you get for the main course? Let's move this along.
All right. Quick thing about the... they did eventually bring us the frog legs, and we're like, this isn't frog legs. What is this?
So you were upset with them.
I wasn't super mad, but I was like, this definitely isn't what we ordered. So Caroline, the guy just came by, and Caroline was just, hey, this isn't frog legs. And it's also not what we wanted to eat. And the guy just like apologized profusely and came back in a few minutes with frog legs, which, let me tell you, they are weird. Frog legs are like chicken made of fish. I don't know how else to describe it. It is chicken made of fish.
Chicken fish.
Yeah, it's really weird.
Okay.
But okay, moving on.
What did you get for the main course?
I got some sort of salmon in a pastry with mushrooms and some sauce.
How did you come to picking this?
I was looking for fish.
So this has fish in it. I'll just get that.
Yeah.
Do they have like normal things on the menu that people wouldn't know what they are? Or is just everything is just like, oh, okay. How much is that? $200?
Not that much.
I have a story to tell about going to a restaurant.
Oh.
In New York City.
Oh.
So it was me and my friend. It was actually my friend Marty who was on the show way back doing some guitar stuff for a couple episodes. Remember the time that my mic was off and you refused to tell me that I was off? Well, we'll forget that for now. That was him. Anyway. So we're in New York City, we're walking around and doing some stuff, and I think we're going to like guitar stores and all that. And then we're like, let's get some food. And we're looking at some area, I don't remember exactly where it was. But we're like, we were in an area we didn't really know what was around. Looking for food, there wasn't much. And we find one restaurant, just go in. You know, you go in, it's normal, whatever, it looks fine. The guy sits you down. And then he gives us the menus. And I think we ordered stuff first, we ordered like drinks first. I got like a soda, whatever, you got like something. And the guy goes to get the drinks, and then he gives us the menu, and the cheapest thing was like $80.
What?
Yeah, like the cheapest dish was like $80, and it went up to like $400 for like a Kobe steak and stuff. And I was like, what the hell are we going to do? I can't pay for this. You know, there's nothing, what are we going to do here? We're still freaking out. So I'm like, all right, I'm going to go into the bathroom. I'm going to go into the bathroom. You exit, then call me when you're outside, and I will come out. And then we just had to leave. We probably could have just told the guy, you know, we can't come here, but that would have been even more strange. So we decided just to run away.
Aww.
And then we never came back. That was my story.
Aw, man.
Anyways, so did you like the dinner?
Yeah, it was really good.
Did the girlfriend like the dinner as well?
Oh, yeah. Yeah, she really seemed to enjoy it.
What'd you guys do after that?
We had creme brulee and a molten chocolate cake.
Was it from there or was it from another place?
No, from there.
How many stars do you give the restaurant?
Five?
Five out of five is it was great?
Well, any restaurant that has an aquarium shaped like a polar bear that looks like it's made out of ice filled with fish on the upper floor is pretty cool in my book.
Yeah.
And they had two Picassos, so...
What would Gordon Ramsay say if he was in there? If Gordon Ramsay came in and ate some of that food, what would he say?
He would just start swearing.
You think he would? He wouldn't like it?
No, he just...
Tastes like piss? What would he say?
Excuse me, I think he would have liked it.
I want to go to a restaurant and just start acting like Ramsay and see what people do.
Just wear a chef hat.
Tastes like a donkey's dick. Which he has said. I'm just quoting him. I'm not being vulgar. That's something he said. Like, I don't know how he would know how that tastes. But I wonder like how that would work if you just started doing that. You know?
But
So you had a good day?
Yeah.
Are you happy about it? What do you feel about this? I'm sure you're happy about it. I shouldn't have asked you that. But what are your feelings on the Revel thing? 6 months and all that stuff?
No, it's great. I am really, really happy.
And in a roundabout way, you kind of met her through the show. If the show did not exist...
If you didn't film her business partner shaking her butt, this would not have happened.
Oh, yeah?
Mm-hmm.
So it was kind of
a great story to tell everybody.
So it was kind of because of me. In a lot of ways.
I wouldn't have made it to MAGFest without you that year. Although,
yeah.
Interestingly enough.
Yes, tell me.
There were no fewer than three other conventions where we were both in the same room.
Right.
Twice for many hours.
Yeah, but you know what? You didn't go up to and talk to her. I'm the one that pushes you, John.
I never even saw her.
I'm the one that takes you. You're like a raw element in the wilderness, and I take you and I mold you, and I put you in other locations where you could prosper. So, you know, I made this happen for you, and I deserve a present. Maybe you should take me to the Russian tea room, because I feel like I was left behind, and I feel upset.
Aw, don't...
Anyway, well, that's good, man. Congratulations and all that stuff.
Very much.
So anyway, I got Injustice. I want to talk about that. Injustice, Gods Among Us.
Oh, man, I got through the tutorial today.
You did the tutorial, that was it?
And I did some verses last night.
So yesterday it came out, and I went to Plane Trade, and they had the game set up, and a couple of people showed up. Joe showed up over there. Joe, who of course, shows up in some of the videos. He was there, a couple other people. We started playing in the store.
Hippo guy's here.
I wound up being there for like 3 hours, because I was playing it, and then other people started coming in, like other customers, and all of a sudden there was a bunch of people playing. And I was like, this is like when there was arcades, you know? Strangers. This stranger wants to beat me in this game, but he cannot because I'm so much better than him. That didn't really happen, but it's like this guy wants to beat me in the game, and I want to beat him, and he's a human being that's in the room with me. This is amazing.
And we can actually talk at each other and shake hands when we're done.
Yeah, yeah. So it's kind of a flashback for me. I was like, whoa. It's like 10 years ago, you know? But maybe more like 12 years ago, but... it's been a while, but we really had a great time there. We were pretty much all night playing, and I really like the game a lot.
Really, that's good to hear. I haven't gotten through the story mode yet, but from Versus, playing with a D-pad on an Xbox controller.
Well, you have a stick.
Yeah, I wasn't at home.
Okay. I highly recommend for people that get this game. I highly recommend you read the comics or at least a few of the issues.
Yeah.
Because the storyline is just so much better in the comic.
Did they water it down?
No, they've basically ruined it.
I've read the comics up until the most recent episode.
Well, we've been talking about the comic for weeks now on the show, and what we like about it is that it's something completely out of the ordinary, how it's so different and how it's so out there, you know, and they're really taking chances with it. But when you play it in the game, it quickly turns into another generic multiverse thing. Within 10 minutes. You're not even in that universe. There's different. It's the multiverse again, and then within 10 minutes, you know how it's going to end. Basically, you know,
it's not the same as the comic.
It's the same as the comic, but with the comic is the universe, right?
Yeah.
And then there's other universes, and then they start crossing over and all that usual stuff. So that was kind of like, it just turned into another one of those multiverse stories, but it's still good though.
Is it worth $60 is the real question.
Yeah, I think so. I enjoyed it. I actually played the story mode all the way through. I didn't even... I think I went to the bathroom, but I did play. I think it was like 4 hours, maybe. 3.5 to 4 hours. And so I did enjoy it. But some stuff, they just rushed through it. Like, because, you know, the thing everyone's complaining about is, oh, how could so-and-so fight with this other guy? How could that be possible? If he hit him like that, he would be dead.
Science!
Yes, because I understand the science of comic books. But they just kind of throw stuff. Oh, there's a pill they take that's Kryptonian that gives them the abilities of Superman or the power level of him. That's just really...
That's kind of... Well, he should take the pill then. He should take all the pills.
What if he took the pill? Yeah. I don't know. So I want you to play the story mode, and then we can talk about it more.
All right.
I'm sure a lot of people are still playing it, so I don't want to spoil things.
Yeah, I will not spoil anything.
But it really is like very, very much like a... Kissing Batman's ass, because it's like,
because he's the only DC character that everyone still
loves. Because in that universe they're like, all of the heroes are either dead or turned evil except for one, and you're like, oh, I wonder who that is, and it's like, it's him. So he's the only pure one out of all his heroes. He's the only pure one that there was.
Oh, come on, John, like Green Lantern would ever turn evil.
They didn't really explain why some of them turned evil. They just did. And then, like, Shazam and Black Adam are on the same side, but they don't really... I don't know. It goes through it too quick, but I really enjoy the comic. I think the comic
is great.
We thought it would be done by now, but it keeps going and going.
Yeah.
I don't think it's ever going to end.
Yo, if anybody out there got the, what's it called? The trade paperback with the collector's edition?
I don't think it has all of them, though.
Yeah, I want to know how many issues it's got.
Yeah.
Yeah, and I gotta go with Sturmgeist on this one. He says, no booster gold, no purchase. I bought it anyway, but Booster Gold would be hilarious.
They'll be in it.
DLC in all the way.
Well, I think Lobo. There's already like people found pictures, and there's gonna be so many stages and characters and all that. So
someone's.
I will buy them all, and I will probably complain about a lot of it, but I'll keep doing it.
Yeah.
But I really do enjoy the game quite a bit, and I want to get into it more. I mean, I'm probably gonna play it tonight. I have not played online yet. Some people are asking.
Yeah.
I want to learn how to play first before I go against the guy who's spamming the two things that he saw in a video that people use.
I do want to say, though, that the tutorial...
Yeah, like, good.
The tutorial's really good, and it gets you up to a point and says, okay, you've pretty much got everything. If you want to do advanced stuff, that's cool. If you want to start playing the game now, that's fine.
Yeah.
Because I've played other games where you hit the tutorial and it's like... Like, Marvel vs. Capcom 3, great example. Punch. Sweet, I did it. Punch, kick. Yeah. Hadouken. Woohoo.
Yeah.
Punch, kick. Sweep, cancel, launch. Kick, punch. Special, super, team super. Mm-hmm. To complete. Like, what?
Mm-hmm.
There's a bit of a jump here.
Yeah. Well, I really love the game. Combines my favorite 2D fighting games with comic books. And good games combined.
Yeah.
So that's
although it's more Mortal Kombat-y than Street Fighter-y.
Yeah, but it's okay. Mortal Kombat was good.
No, it's good. It's good. Mortal Kombat, was it 9? New Mortal Kombat, is that 9?
Yeah, you liked it, yeah.
That game kicks off in butt.
All right, so we got about 6 minutes to do the comments. I'm going to take a couple of these out.
Sick.
Just go from the top. I'll tell you when to stop.
Okay.
And well, if I apologize, we'll definitely make it up. The ones that we don't do today, we'll do it another future time. So it's not like we're just going to throw them out. Okay. And you still have that big document with all of them, remember? I gave you?
Somewhere, yes.
Well, we still have that too, so.
Cool.
All right, let's keep going here.
For LJ Stability says, to OJ, John, and my fellow Ramborgians, what do you think the Ramborgian beard style should be? And Arnold Smet replied, Hitler's mustache, Elvis Presley sideburns, and a soul patch.
That's a nice combination, but I think we'd have to, like, if you want to have the official, look, you'd have to have a long-haired ponytail, and then you'd have to have, glasses, because everyone wears glasses here for some reason.
Because we're blind.
Well, I have to wear them because I never really talked about this, but I have an issue with my eyes, where I can't wear contacts right now. I'll probably talk about it a future time.
Okay.
But I can't remember how to wear contacts for a while. But anyway, and you'd have to have a beard like this.
Oh,
that's what you'd have to have.
But I don't beard.
Well, I have to be represented. You don't want me part of it?
I want everyone part of it, but I can't do all of those things.
And you have to have shaved arms, as we talked about last week as well. Okay.
Next comment is from Zandrunas.
Yeah.
John, I will buy your next year's arm hair for $10,000.
Yeah, we talked about this last week. Once a year, I shave. We do some grooming. And, I can't sell it because I keep it all. I have it. I can't tell you what I'm doing with it. It will serve a purpose in the end that will benefit mankind in many great ways. Or possibly cause severe pain to OJ. One or the other. I'm not sure which one.
Oh, gosh. A friend of mine told me he made a friend of his made a super awesome paintbrush.
Yeah.
I think it was either plucked eyelashes or plucked eyebrows.
Wow.
And he'd been working on this for a very long time.
Why did he do this? Why are you friends with this
person? He wanted the ultimate paintbrush.
And hair is like the best thing to use?
Well, people have been using horsehair brushes for ages.
Yeah, that's true.
Yeah.
Okay.
All right. Moving on, because we don't have much time.
Yeah.
Macca Joe states, we have an Outback Steakhouse in Australia. Steakception.
Yeah, we had Joel on last week. We were talking about Australia.
And like, the fact that I can't pronounce Melbourne.
And I brought up the we just did it right now. Outback Steakhouse. They have that there.
Who would have thought?
Is that even an Australian company? Is that like an American company? They went there.
Probably American, because America does weird things.
Yeah, that's kind of weird, right?
Yeah.
Would you go to one there if you were there?
For fun, maybe. I've been to a McDonald's in every country I've been to but Canada, so why not an Outback in Australia? I've been to an Outback in Japan as well.
They had that there?
Yeah, a friend of mine would get a cheeseburger there every week because he needed a cheeseburger or he would have died.
One of the best things I had in Japan was Chinese food.
Go figure, right?
Yeah, it was a little better. It was like a little cleaner.
Mm.
Than what we get. MSG all over the place.
Yeah, and I don't really like those sports networks. So, moving on. A question was posed by our dear Fabreze. What is StayBallsy? But don't worry, folks. Raiden X got this one under control. It's a way of life, my brother.
Yeah, that's all you could say, really. It's not something tangible that can be explained or shown. It's just something that exists. You know?
Yeah, it's... What more do you want?
There you go, yeah.
It's just a way to look at life and go through life and something to share with those you care about.
Mm-hmm. In the woods with costumes on, eating the same food.
Cheeseburger.
Are you taking me to the Russian tea room or not?
Do you really want to go, John?
Would you take me if I like made a stink about it? Like, I feel like you should take... Like, let's say I called you, right? It's like 2 a.m., right? I call you and I'm all upset.
And my phone actually answers.
Yeah, and I go, I'm really upset about this. I feel like, you know, we were friends for a long time. You never really took me to a really nice dinner. And I want you to take me to this place, pay for it. I feel like you owe me that much. What would you do?
I think you deserve a very nice meal.
You're just saying that because we're on the air. You'd be like, get the hell, what are you talking about? You're shaking up the phone.
No, I'm budgeting it in my head.
You start budgeting it? That's nice of you.
I have a pretty good estimate of how much it would cost to take you to that restaurant.
I probably could. You said that to me, I probably would just be like, hold on, I'm going to record this. But then, yeah, I don't know. No, okay, hey, I will not.
That would be in exchange for all the t-shirts.
What? What was that?
That would be in exchange for all the t-shirts.
I don't even get it. All right, whatever.
Excellent.
I don't even understand what you said. Just keep going.
All right.
We got about a minute, so just do it.
And Timberland 18. Timberland 18.5 says, "Where's Howard? Long overdue for an appearance."
Howie's going to come out soon. He was supposed to come out a couple weeks ago, but didn't work out the last minute. He's got a good job now, and he's actually moving as well. He's moving to a town over, so he's involved in that right now.
Is he getting closer or farther?
He's moving like where Phil is, so it's like not very far from where he is now.
Okay.
But he's got a bigger house.
Nice.
And he's doing really well, and he's got a good job at Coca-Cola, and sometimes he has to go stay in other cities for like a couple days at a time.
Wow.
And then they bring him back and stuff, so he's pretty busy, but we're going to try to get him in over the next couple weeks. I'm definitely going to try to do that. So see if we can pull it off.
Okay. So I typically avoid trying to say where I work on the internet, so hopefully
he talks about it.
All right, cool.
All right, that's going to do it for the comments section. We'll use the other ones later. All right. Hold on to those, Johnny. I just wanted, before we call Ed, I want to bring up this dude's name's Ion Rec. And he made we talked about a video, so we should make a video game, right?
Yeah.
And he made a Ramborgian game. I wasn't able to try it out. I think you messed with it a little bit. You're having trouble on your work computer.
Yeah, it just kept... I kept getting the blue screen.
But you can check that out at sourceforge.net/projects/Ramborgia game.
Yeah.
And I guess you could try that out. It looks like it's pretty cool.
Props to you for making this, man. I'm sorry. I haven't been able to get it to run yet. I don't know what tweaks I got to do.
Yeah.
I don't know if... I'm not going to ask you to send me the source code to see if I build it myself, it'll run. But, I want to say thank you very much.
Yeah, if we tried, we'll have to talk to him more about that. But
yeah,
there you go. So let's see if Mr. Ed is around right now. There we go.
Nice.
Let's see if we can get him.
Hey. Hello.
Hey.
Hey. Hey.
How's it going, sir?
I'm all right. How you doing?
We're doing good. We don't have your video. What's going on with that?
You don't have video?
No.
All right. Well, let me see. John Harrington wants to show video, except, yes, except. Okay. There we go. Did that do it?
No. Oh, there we go. All right.
Oh, except. There we go.
Okay.
Yeah, it's loading now.
Oh, there we go.
Okay.
All right. I think you have the, Ed, I think you have the stream playing. Can you just close out the stream?
Say again?
I think you have our, you're watching, I guess. You have to close out the actual stream that you were watching.
Close it out.
Yes, just exit out and you'll be all right.
Is that better?
Yeah, I think that's good. Yep.
Cool.
Did it?
We got it. We're all set.
You're seeing video on this call because, all right, Firefox.
We're all set.
Oh, no. Firefox has stopped working.
No, don't worry about that. You're fine.
Okay, I'll close that out.
So, ladies and gentlemen, my favorite person in the world is a legend making his monthly visit. The great Ed Trotta is here, sir.
So, how are Schnozman and Hole Punch doing today? Did you talk about that?
We talked a little bit about it. We're filming, and we got kicked out of a location a couple weeks ago.
Oh, good for you! That's always the way to go.
We went back to it. We went back to it this week. We were able to finish what we were trying to do, so we're all set. And yeah, one of the episodes is almost done, and then we got two more that are a little bit not there yet, but we're getting there. So
I'm on the edge of my seat. I'm waiting with bated breath.
Oh gosh, we can't wait. It's killing
us. I tried
us.
Watching the show today, what you were doing today,
yes.
But I had a visit from the maintenance man.
Uh-oh.
With an elevator repairman who needed to get into my storage closet, which is right next to the elevator. I said, okay, you have until 10 of 6, okay?
Yeah.
Then you got to get out, and their machines were making my dog crazy.
Oh, jeez.
And so I kept coming back to see what you were talking about.
Yeah.
And I only caught glimpses of Russian tea room and escargot and.
Yeah, don't worry about it. It wasn't very good today. We were just kind of we were lost, but we're here.
Lost?
We're back on track. We got Ed. Ed's going to save the show today.
Okay. How am I going to do that?
Just by being here, sir. Just by being here.
I did see a message, you know, that they float down the right on the screen, and
yeah.
I was trying to check while the machines were going on, and
yeah.
I saw a comment from a guy named Mark Crown Stories.
Oh, yes.
Yeah.
Yes.
And I caught the very beginning of the show. Before the guys show up, I heard you talking about what happened in Boston on Monday.
Right.
What can we do to improve the world? How can we contribute? How can we change the way things are going down? I really appreciated, you know, your thoughts, your efforts, your contribution along that line. You know, we're just not used to having bombs go off,
right.
You know, on our American soil. You know, I don't think since the Civil War have we had a war go on, you know, at home.
Yeah.
It rattles us. It rattles us big time. And I went to school at the University of New Hampshire, and I went down to Boston, you know, whenever I could. And so, yeah, my heart's with them, too.
Yeah.
So I really appreciated all that you were trying to promote there about, you know, improving life.
Right.
Somehow by just doing estimable acts or the random act of kindness. You know, they all sound like corny things. It's true.
Yeah, right.
But there you have it.
It all matters in the end, I think.
Yeah. So yeah. I heard that stuff, and then I saw Mark Crown Stories. Right. Well, humans will kill each other until aliens show up, so we can kill them.
Maybe.
And I really liked that comment because it reminded me of one of my favorite episodes of Outer Limits. If you remember that show at all.
Remember the show, but not the episode.
There was an episode where a group of scientists, five or six scientists, got together and decided that to unite the planet, to unite the nations of the world, what we needed was a common cause, a common threat. They thought an alien invasion would do that. So they drew straws to see which of them would become the alien. And it was an episode that starred Robert Culp, if you know that actor, as the scientist who was turned into an alien And the other scientists created a new form of transportation. They created a laser gun for him. The problem with their whole plot was that the guy didn't land in a city. He landed in some woods somewhere. He encountered some hunters who wounded him. He melted their car with his laser gun, and the whole plot fell apart. But their intent was to create a common cause to unite the planet. Yeah. And that just reminded me of Mark's story, Mark's comment.
We'll have to check that out.
I really hope that it doesn't take something that extreme to get Earth to stop fighting with itself. But the really way things are going, it kind of seems that way right now.
I know. It's not a pretty picture. But you talked about that already. Let's not stay on that foot.
All right. So, Ed,
yeah,
I had an idea, something I was interested in myself, actually. I was wondering, since you're an amazing actor, you've done all these things, I wanted to kind of get inside your head a little bit and see how you would kind of approach certain roles that are out there. And,
excellent. Yeah, so I always like to talk about acting, sure.
I love to hear you talk about acting, so I'll try to, hopefully we get to do that today. So I got a couple roles for you, and we'll throw them your way, kind of get your take on maybe how you'd prepare for it, how you'd kind of interpret it, and what you would do with the role itself, you know. So
fire away.
So the first one I got, an iconic character, probably one of my favorite characters. A couple people have portrayed the character in the movies and TV. Adam West, of course, and all that stuff.
Batman.
So the Dark Knight, the Caped Crusader, Batman. Let's say I was the executive of Warner Brothers. This will never happen, but I said, Ed, I would like you to play Batman in this new television series.
Mm-hmm.
What's the first thing you do in your head as far as, like, I'm going to prepare to be Batman?
I would stock up on the comic books, on what gave Batman the life, his birth, his origins. He was a comic book character. And we saw him in stills. We didn't see him in motion.
Mm.
So, you know, there are poses. And I would look for those poses, those pictures. I would look to recreate them. You know, playing a superhero, he had this stance very often.
Right.
You know, that hands on hip kind of thing. Superman had that too.
Oh, yeah.
Batman's was better, I think, because he had a better cape. He had the best cape.
Yeah.
Let's face it, with the scalloped black thing. Oh, yeah. And I would try to recreate the stills that were in the comic books, because I think it's important to satisfy the image rather than try to make something your own. I know Batman has been a revolving door for actors. Adam West, yeah. Then who was it that did the original? Wasn't it Keaton? Michael Keaton?
Michael Keaton,
yeah.
And...
You had George Clooney in there.
Clooney played Batman. Now Christopher's...
Christian Bale.
Christian Bale, right. Yep. He's played a couple.
He did three.
Batman's a revolving door for a star vehicle, as a vehicle for stars.
Mm-hmm.
But I would go to the pictures. That's what I did with Don Quixote when I was doing Man of La Mancha. I went to the book and I looked at the plates.
Right.
The illustrations, and tried to find as many opportunities to look like the plate, look like the picture as I could. Because it's more important to satisfy a viewer's image than it is to kind of create your own.
It's already established things. You don't have to recreate the wheel.
Yeah. Hmm. That's the same. Batman's the same with Superman, or Spider-Man is another comic book that came to the big screen.
Right. Yeah.
And, you know, you'd want to fly like that, one hand up, one hand down, one knee bent, one leg straight, you know.
Right.
So
you pretty much study the character and learn as much as you can about the character you're going to portray.
Exactly.
Huh. Okay. Here's another one for you. Kind of a different take. So that was a hero character. What if you were to play like a villain, maybe like a mafia boss? I've seen a lot of these different movies that have come out, Godfather, stuff like that.
Oh, sure. Well, Godfather is like the definitive mafia boss movie.
Oh, yeah, absolutely.
Villain, you say villain, And then you say Mafia Boss.
It's a little different, yeah. Things. You're right,
because,
you're right.
Because, you know, I often play the bad guy, especially, you know, on film, because I'm just because I'm dark and I don't have a perfect complexion. And, you know, so, yeah, I'm usually the bad guy. But I like that. Villainy is a much better category to be in than the goody two-shoes. Richard Burton said his least favorite role ever was Ferdinand in The Tempest. Because it was he was the sort of the male ingenue, the romantic lead, and he hated it.
Right.
It's much more fun to be a villain. And Mafia, Godfather is a good example, because if you notice, the higher up the character is, the less he has to enforce any kind of power.
Huh.
Power. You know, he Marlon Brando was so soft-spoken.
Right.
Well, you come to my house, you ask this favor of me, and you never ask me for a cup of coffee or a visit, so why should I do this thing for you? It's so casual, it's practically, you know,
He didn't have to scream and yell because everyone paid so close attention to what he says.
Exactly. No, the more you scream and yell, the less powerful you are.
So he can speak however he wants to speak, and they will listen to everything he says because he's who he is.
But in terms of villainy, no villain thinks of himself as a villain.
Right, right, right.
They just think of the rest of the world as in conflict with me.
Yeah.
and so you don't act bad. You just, you know, as a villain, you just are trying to fulfill your goal.
Right.
Your motivation. You just happen to be counter to everybody else's thinking.
And woe to anyone who gets in your way.
Yeah. You know, the lower-ranking mafia guys, the hitmen, were the ones that were, you know, remember how hot-headed Sonny was.
Right.
The Godfather.
Yeah.
You know, one of my favorite scenes was smashing the guy with the garbage can.
Oh, it's over and over again, kicking him.
Yeah, because he was messing with his sister, you know.
Right, yeah.
Hotheads. Villains villains are fun to play, and the higher up the mafia, the softer spoken they get. And power is something that you don't take on stage. Dracula's a good example. When I played Dracula, I discovered that you don't try to be powerful. You let others give you power. Power is given. It's not taken on stage anyway. And maybe it is in life and politics also. You give someone power. It's not me. All I did was this.
Right.
And Renfield would go, master, master. And he was the one to give me the power.
It's the reaction. If everyone just stood there, if everyone stands there and goes, I don't care, then you don't seem as powerful.
Right.
That's what you're saying. Wow.
Right. And there's Van Helsing saying, he's too dangerous not to believe. You must believe. With all these people dwelling on the power of Dracula, and then the less you do, the better off you are.
Right, right.
Huh. You don't need to. They're all doing it for you.
Exactly. Yes,
they're selling. They're selling the power, man.
All I say is, Wilhelmina, come to me and share the mystery of the night. Suddenly she just comes swooping down the stairs, falling into my arms, and you know she gives me the power. Dracula was a lesson in that, in less is more. The less you do, the better off you are.
What kind of, did you have to wear like a teeth, prosthetic teeth of some sort? Fangs?
Oh, well, I had fangs made that were caps. I had caps. I'm glad you brought that up, because in almost every other production of Dracula, there would be this moment where he would go behind his cape, you know, and pop the fangs in, and then come up and go in for the bite. And, you know, my research on a character is always the source. So I read the novel, Dracula, by Bram Stoker.
Oh,
and
nice.
Jonathan Harker writes to Wilhelmina, this guy has some awesome teeth. They're there all the time.
Right, right.
The teeth are there all the time. And that's what I did when I played Dracula, was have caps made that were there. No, it would take too long for me to go get them. I still have them in my makeup kit. But
nice.
I wore them all the time. And you know, it just takes a little while and people get used to them.
Like, were they really big or just a little bit bigger than regular teeth?
Well, I had two pair. Oh. I had my Saturday Night Fangs, which were a little longer. And they were just noticeable. I could speak with them. They didn't impair my enunciation.
Right.
When the production was over, did you ever just kind of take the teeth with you, like the smaller teeth with you somewhere and just have them in and just walk around and see if people notice?
No, but I would put them on. I would go as Dracula to the next couple of Halloween parties. Or, you know, I still have the fangs.
Wow.
A little polygrip, and they pop right on. They were made for me, so.
I'm just picturing.
How many people have custom-made fangs in the world? There's only probably a few that ever had custom-made fangs for them. I mean, it's pretty good.
You know, I'm just thinking to myself, like, what if you get pulled over one day? The guy comes, do you know how fast you were going, sir? No, I don't. And you just, like, got the fangs out. Like, I'd just love to see the look on the dude's face.
I think you should try that, John. You should try that out and see what happens, right?
I'd rather not.
We'll put some fangs on. You'll have you drive as fast as you can until you get pulled over, and we'll see what happens.
I'd rather be dressed as Lincoln if I got stopped by the cops.
Oh, yeah. Well, you know.
Yeah.
I'm late for a debate.
Can't give a ticket to Lincoln. I mean, that's just messed up.
You need a convertible to fit the hat.
No, actually, my I drive a Lincoln, and I can put the hat on, but
that's why it's called a Lincoln.
I can't get into. That's why it's called a Lincoln, but I can't get into the car. I have to. But no, I don't drive with the hat on.
Gotcha. Right.
So I got a couple other couple of roles. This is kind of a weird one.
Uh huh.
And so, one of the movies I like Godzilla, King Kong monster movies.
Oh,
If you were a character in one of these movies.
Yeah.
How do you prepare for something like? Because a lot of times maybe you're talking to something that's not even there. It's probably maybe a digital.
Well, we're not talking about being the monster. We're not talking about being Godzilla.
We could do that as well if you.
We're talking about being like the people in the streets.
What if you're like a guy, and you see the monster and you have to act like it's there, but you're not actually.
Oh, you have to do this whole thing.
Right.
Right. Well, yeah. I used that not that long ago when I was mounting Moby Dick on stage, putting the classic Moby Dick on stage, and all the sailors had to go to the apron of the stage, see the whale out in the ocean, and react to it. You know, the only trouble is getting everyone's eye line to go to the same point so that the whale can move a little bit. Then the whale can be as big as you want it to be. It's all because it's in your imagination. My favorite part about those old Godzilla flicks and the people running on the streets with the styrofoam rocks that were always falling.
Did you ever have to deal with stuff like that?
The street,
you know? Did you ever work with stuff like that, like props like that, is weird stuff that just looks horrible when you're maybe filming, but then when you watch it on TV, it looks good, but when you're doing it, it's just like ridiculous?
Well, I noticed that the sets of most of the soap operas, you're not supposed to call them soap operas anymore. They're daytime drama.
Oh, really? Okay.
Those
I'm glad
sets
you told
are
me that.
Cheesy looking if you're on them.
What do they look like? Just
oh, cheap? Well, you know, like the outdoors, it's just AstroTurf. You know?
It's like the Brady Bunch.
Aw.
Well, you know, those and game shows. I was on $10,000 Pyramid in 74, and I got to see the Ed Sullivan Theater sort of game props room, you know, and the wheels that get spun and the props, they look better on TV. it all looks better on TV. The daytime dramas and the game shows, the equipment is pretty handmade, nailed together.
Right.
But they photograph well, and that's all that's important.
Yeah, really.
Just make it shiny. No one will notice.
Mm-hmm.
So what if you're playing the opposite? You're playing the monster yourself.
If you're playing the monster?
You're a monster. You got
in a suit, in a big monkey suit, a big Godzilla suit.
That's the movie. A giant Ed's walking around destroying stuff. How do you prepare for this?
Then you'd internalize. You would have to internalize. Oh, this was an exercise that I did with Animal Farm. When I put Animal Farm on stage, we did a lot of internalizing exercises where the actors started from the interior. They changed their organs. They changed the size of their heart or their, the size of their bodies. And that's just a matter of suspending belief and trying to, you know, how big is Godzilla's brain? We heard that the dinosaurs had tiny, tiny brains. Mm. In fact, the Brontosaurus was so big it needed two brains in order to be able to move both the front and rear ends. That's what I heard. I don't know. But what would you have to do to become a creature like that? It'd be a lot of, yeah, that would be an acting challenge. That would certainly be something. I'd like to hear what Stanislavski would have to say about it. Although he recommended imagining being an animal. Animal work was very important to him in creating a character, which is like the Bible for actors. You know, it's good to pick an animal. I remember a giraffe being the animal that I thought Don Quixote was.
Wow.
Because the neck and the way he would stand. I just chose a giraffe to emulate in terms of that, in terms of movement or appearance. Hmm. I don't know. Does that answer the question about being a monster?
I think it does.
I'd probably find a family of groundhogs and terrorize them a little bit just to know what it felt like. Okay, I wouldn't do that. I like groundhogs. They're cute.
Yeah, no, that's a good idea. Yeah, to be a giant, you'd want to... well, I don't know what I would do about that in L.A. Although I live in Koreatown, there are lots of Shih Tzus and tiny dogs, you know.
Aww.
That I could terrorize.
Do you think is it more difficult to portray a very intelligent character or a character that, like we're talking, like a monster, like a mindless character? Or both challenging?
Well, yeah, they would both be challenging. The intelligence... It would probably be written on the page. Mm. So, I mean, I always worry about that with legalese. For a little while, when I first got to L.A., I did courtroom dramas. I did the judge, I did divorce court, superior court, and I was usually either an attorney or a witness, a doctor or a lawyer, and it's just the language that's kind of daunting, you know.
Right.
To remember and to say with ease that as if you know what it is that you're saying,
like it's
talking about.
Right.
But those are supposedly intelligent characters. No, I mean, they're, you know, it's just, that's just a language. They're just professional characters. I remember directing the guy who played the major in Animal Farm, because those are the first words you hear out of an animal. Is the first words are "fellow animals, I shall not be with you too much longer." The major knows he's going to die, but he wants to share with them this idea that, you know, we are the creatures of the earth who fertilize it, who grow things. We don't need man. Man is the enemy. He's the one who gives them that whole idea. And I remember working with this actor on being a creature that bridges that span and gets to speak. It's a miracle that he can speak, but the play is premised on that, so we got to get to it. So that was a fun rehearsal. I remember that.
Very cool. So Ed, something I want to talk about. You mentioned this last week. You brought up, we were having some kind of conversation. I don't know what it was about. But you brought up that you were considered to be a hippie, or you consider yourself to be a hippie. I assume in the 60s, and not before or after that. But why don't you kind of explain to everyone at home, what does that mean? What did that mean to be a hippie, and what was that all about?
Ah, no. What's interesting initially is that, you know, your verb tense is both present and past.
Oh, okay. So you still got this going on.
Is one a hippie? Was one a hippie?
Are you always one?
Is once
this
a
is what we're here to find out today.
I don't know.
This is what we're here to find out today.
Well, you know, the precepts of being a hippie were basically centered around free love. Love. Love is all you need. You know, to quote John Lennon, all we are saying is give peace a chance. You know, the hippie movement was... politically, it was centered around a rejection of the war in Vietnam. It was a revolt against that. It was demonstrating against that. And, you know, war is not the answer. What it was like to be a hippie is, you know, we were or are a very passive, we believe in the collective consciousness, Mother Nature is like God's better half. God, I don't know, it's hard to put hippiedom into a nutshell. Mm. It was an explosion. It was, you know, there was an attire, there was a look.
Right.
You know, you grew your hair. I did the show Hair.
Oh, okay.
Which was the tribal love rock musical.
Right.
Anti-war tribal love rock musical. And it was the first nude scene. It was one of the most liberal feeling, most freeing that I ever felt on stage. I was a tribe member. I was a principal character, Wolf. I had a solo. The song title was Sodomy.
Oh, wow.
Okay.
Yeah. Why do these words sound so nasty?
So you had, like you said, there's a look to it and everything.
So there was a look. You grew your hair. You grew a beard. You got a winter coat.
Yeah.
You were beat. You know, hippies followed, the hippie generation kind of followed the beat generation, Jack Kerouac and On the Road. And those guys were beat. Not just beat, but they were beat down. They were survivors of the Depression. They were... they were beaten, and I guess hippies followed that. And since then, there's been like Generation Next, Generation X.
Right.
There have been, you know, I don't hear that often. I don't hear generational titles. I think right now it's Generation Text.
They don't know what to call them anymore, I think. There's new letters.
There was a word. Millennials. Aren't they called millennials now, people
millennials?
Nowadays?
Okay.
Usually I've heard it used as a somewhat mildly derogatory term towards to people who... I expect to be entitled to everything, but yeah.
Okay.
So Ed, let me ask you this question. So you said there's a certain attire that you wore during this time period. So when you put this stuff on, you walk around outside. Is there some resistance to this? People kind of don't like what you're wearing or anything like that go on?
Well, for my 40th birthday, I had a surprise party and everyone wore tie dye.
Oh wow.
It was
flashback.
Yeah, it was flashback. Yeah, I pretty much tie-dyed everything I owned that was white to be colorful.
What do people think about this? Your parents and other people around you, were they upset about this?
Well, yeah, in the late 60s, early 70s, when I was in college, and that was when I discovered... sex, drugs, and rock and roll, baby. for a little while.
Was there something that, like one moment you could pinpoint?
Because until then, I wore suits. I wore a suit every day to high school.
Oh, yeah? Is that what most people wore?
I was in parochial school. I had to wear a shirt and tie and jacket.
That's
a
bummer.
That's what most people wore to school. A full suit.
God. That's what everyone wore to Fordham Prep. That's where I went to school.
Oh, really?
Archbishop Stepanak. I was so glad to be going to school and not having to wear a suit.
Yeah, right.
Took you pretty far down the other direction then, huh?
The opposite direction.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Opposite direction. You can say that again. Yeah.
Things changed so much during that time period. I mean, just you look at 1964 when the Beatles first came, and then within 5 years later, things looked completely different, sounded very different, and that's in a five-year span. You know, pop culture and all that stuff changed dramatically. I don't think there's ever been another span like that since then. where things change so much.
You're probably right. When the Beatles got here, that was considered long hair.
Right. Yeah. Then you look at you look at 1970, and then you're totally different.
Completely different. I don't think that the Beatles actually were in England. They were considered rockers.
Right.
Whereas the Dave Clark Five were considered mods.
The rockers and the mods.
Rockers and the mods. The Beatles wore those the black shoes with the and with heels, and they dressed kind of dark.
Right.
Dave Clark Five were, you know, I think had turtlenecks, and they were more, they were practically yuppies now. You know, considered. They had their own factions, and I'm not sure to what extent. Well, yeah, the Beatles contributed enormously to the whole generational development of my era, my generation. John Lennon's music begins and ends my Lincoln play.
Really? I didn't know that.
It starts with "All We Are Saying Is Give Peace a Chance."
Wow.
Because that was a song that was chanted on the steps of the Lincoln Memorial when they were having anti-Vietnam War demonstrations.
Right.
And when the curtain comes down, blackout, "Power to the People" comes on. Because that's what Lincoln was about, was trying to follow the precepts of what he genuinely believed in his heart to be the will of the people, despite what his cabinet thought.
Right.
So, John Lennon, I was on 72nd Street in 1980 when he was assassinated.
Wow.
And I hear the sirens. I heard the sirens, and I heard the whispers like a wave, you know. John Lennon was shot.
Wow.
John Lennon dead, died. It was devastating.
Hmm.
And he articulated, he articulated a lot of. If I can play you a song, do I have time to play a song?
Oh, absolutely, yes.
Go for it. We love it.
I had thought of something else, but no, this was really imagine there's no heaven. It's easy if you try. No hell below us. Above us, only sky. Imagine all the people living for today. Imagine there's no countries. It isn't hard to do. Nothing to kill or die for. And no religion too. Imagine all the people living life in peace. You may say I'm a dreamer, but I'm not the only one. I hope someday you'll join us, and the world will live as one. Imagine no possessions. I wonder if you can. No need for greed or hunger. A brotherhood of man. Imagine all the people living, sharing all the world. You may say I'm a dreamer, but I'm not the only one. I hope someday you'll join us, and the world will live as one.
Very nice, sir.
I lost my way there a little bit in the middle, but that was an attitude that I, you know, embraced, certainly, in my hippiedom. Oh, yeah. And it's a very communistic sort of thinking, really. If you read the manifesto, if you read the Communist Manifesto, it's really actually a pretty idyllic idea. Communism didn't turn out to be like the manifesto.
Right.
You know, because, well, that's what Animal Farm was about. You throw a little power at the pigs, and suddenly, you know, power corrupts, and absolute power will corrupt absolutely.
Right.
But the precepts of it were idyllic. You know,
right.
The seven commandments of animalism were a lot like that.
Hmm.
It just didn't work. It's not in the nature of man.
No, it's not.
Sadly.
Fortunately.
Sadly.
So you mentioned to me, I had a conversation with you in the past, you mentioned you went to Woodstock, but it didn't really work out.
Oh, man. It's almost embarrassing that I was there because I left. You know, it was rainy and I had a job, but the guy that I was working with saw in the paper, hey, there's this concert and it's not that far from here. We should go. We went, and there was a place where the fence was down, and you know, and a guy was supposed to be guarding it, but he let everybody in. And I saw Shanana, but then we had to go to work, and we left. And later, when I realized what we had been to and what we should have stayed at,
right.
I didn't tell people. I started not telling people that I went to Woodstock because...
Was Sean and I like the first act that went on stage, I think? And then maybe it blew up after that?
You know what? I don't remember.
I think that's true.
Was it?
That might have been like the first thing that they had, and there was less people there. And then that's when all hell broke loose, and they made it a free show, and everyone showed up. So.
Okay. Well, that makes sense of my experience with it.
Yeah.
No? because I thought it was a free show.
Okay.
I didn't know why there was a fence there at all. you know, because I was a hippie by then.
Right, right.
So take down the fences, man. Take down the fences.
Right. Let me ask you this. So I said you were a hippie. I guess you still hold on to a lot of the things you believed in then, or did a lot of things change in the way your perspective?
You know, my thinking was for, and maybe it still is, wait until the people who went through that period, wait until they're in positions of power.
Right.
So that they can influence them, so that they can influence and change. See, the hippie movement didn't really provide much of an alternative. All it was saying was that this isn't the way.
Right.
Because those who argued with us would say, well, show us the way to show us what's better. You know, we're waging war in Vietnam. What should we do? Well, just take the soldiers out of the place. It's not our business. No, but how should we conduct? How do we tax? How do we? We didn't have alternatives. We just said this isn't the way. So we were kind of nihilistic, you know. Mm-hmm. So my thinking was, well, once the people of my generation become get into positions of power where they can impact things. For example, if I became like a superstar and was given the opportunity of looking at scripts and fielding offers, I would pick scripts that promoted this kind of thinking, this positive thinking, this collective consciousness thinking. That's how I would implement my hippie experience. I would embrace scripts in which love overcomes. That's why in the last Academy Awards, I was a big fan of the Silver Lining Playbook. Mm. I thought that was a lovely story about love overcoming, deficiencies.
So,
you know, that's how it would manifest.
Yeah.
So to say someone is or was or is going to be a hippie, it gets a little muddy.
Right. I think, for me, I was born in the 80s, and looking back at that, the 60s time period, there's definitely a lot you can learn from that, what happened there. And I think a lot of times it gets clouded, and people just go, oh, people did drugs, and, oh, it was long hair, drugs, and that's it. But there's a lot more going on there, and the message is really something strong, and I think everyone should understand and know what it's all about.
That's the whole important thing.
Drugs of that era was so mild compared to today.
Right.
You know, there were no pharmaceuticals that I was aware of. You know, people weren't doing Oxycontin and heroin or Percocets and whatever. You know, that stuff was foreign. They were smoking pot and eating mushrooms.
Yeah. And do you feel like that time period gets demonized a lot today? Do you feel like it's demonized at all today? Like they don't want people to go back to try to change things.
Well, my daughter was born in 92. She's 21.
Right.
And driving her to school every day, I would have K Earth on the radio. I'd have the oldies station on, you know. And she'd pop back and forth. But she would say, you know, the songs of that time were more unique. Hmm. And so were the car models. Right. And so were, she started to appreciate the 60s when she was a youngster, when she was just adolescent.
Yeah.
Seeing the difference.
Right.
The 70s were like an awful period for hippies because suddenly we had what was the new dance thing?
Disco.
I love to dance. I love to just dance freeform. You go to a discotheque and everybody was dancing in formation.
Right.
And it was so regimented.
Right.
And it was suddenly a switch there was no individualism anymore.
Yeah.
It was so stylized, and everyone seemed to homogenize.
It's more about looking good than having some kind of substance to you.
I guess. I don't know. I didn't understand it.
It seems to me like during the 60s, you had people that would say, I want to change the world. There's people that said, I want to change things. I want to change the world. And how many people do you run into today that are like, I want to change the world? You hear people very status quo, like, I want to work a 9-to-5, do okay, and settle down, and... Seems like that people were like, I'm going to change things, and I don't know, people had dreams, you know?
I want to change the world. It reminds me of that line from 10 Years After, Alvin Ailey. Ten years after the group, I'd love to change the world, but I don't know what to do, so I leave it up to you. And that was also a very valid sort of disposition. I don't know what to do to change it. I leave it up to you. I just know that this isn't it.
Right.
Change the world. Well, change your point of view. And you know what? Albert Einstein said, life is a beautiful thing. It's just a matter of how you look at it.
Right.
You can dwell on that, and it's kind of a profound thought. People think of Albert Einstein as a mathematician, a scientist, but he was really...
He's got some great quotes. I was looking the other day at all the different things, all these different quotes he has, a lot of real creative things. He was all around great, like that dude.
He was all around great, Albert Einstein. He said, if you want to catch up to me, don't study math, read poetry.
Aw.
Wow.
You know?
Yeah,
way to go.
Awesome, man. Well, Ed, I want to bring up the fan club. It's been up for it's been up for about 2 months, and it's going really well. And I know you did a bunch of work on it recently.
Well, I want to thank you guys for launching it.
The least I could do.
You and Jesse is the other guy? Is the
Jesse made some of the logos. Stringgeist, yep.
And then I got a neighbor, or I got two neighbors involved in helping me with some other stuff that I had. And so, yeah, it's a work in progress. It's a work under construction. And I'm getting emails now from Russia and Japan and Germany.
Oh, that's awesome.
Wow.
Looking for for photographs.
Oh, that's awesome.
Autographs. And I just want, if you know, and I assume a lot of them are coming from your viewership.
Perhaps.
And I want them to know that I'm trying to keep up, but what I'm going to have to do, I've got a file now that are people who have gotten to me, and I'm going to try to come up with a way of scanning a signed headshot,
okay,
and be able to email it back, because I had a heck of a time at the post office with them saying, you have to have a return address. Ever since 9/11, you have to have a return address.
Yeah, absolutely, yeah.
And you can't send postcards anymore. I didn't know that.
What?
Because I couldn't afford all the envelopes. And, yeah, you know, so I was trying to send, I remember Anastasia was the name of the girl that I was trying to send a postcard to.
Right.
And they said, you can't send postcards abroad anymore. That surprised me.
Seriously?
I'm not sure why that. I'm not sure why.
Yeah.
So I'm having a hard time, you know, responding to my fans, but I want them to know how humbled and grateful I am for their support and attention. And, you know, by all means, you know, communicate to me through the fan club page. I go to it and will reply, and we can maintain communication, conversation, dialogue that way, you know, and tell your fans to click on liked, and let's see how many fans we can get, and, you know, let's see where this takes us.
Let's just go all the way with it. So that's it's on Facebook. You can search for Ed Trotta Fan Club on Facebook, or I always put the link in the description of the show on YouTube, so you just click it there and go check it out. Hit the like, see what's going on. We got a lot of good videos on there. I know Ed's Acting Real from the 90s is on there, which I enjoyed. There's a bunch of other clips and real cool stuff. So, Intro to Fan Club, it's time to sign up. That's what's up. So, Ed, man, I really enjoyed talking to you. I look forward to this.
As always.
It's a great honor, sir.
It makes every month go that. It's weird. The month just goes faster when there's something to look forward to.
Yeah, well, Ed's coming next week. I can't wait. Always learn a lot.
I can't either. I look forward to it all day. In fact, when it got to be like 10 of 6, I started getting nervous.
Right.
Oh, gosh, I'm going to do the show now. You know, and of course, if I ever didn't get nervous, I think I'd quit show business.
I know the viewers love you, but this is mostly done for me, so I get to talk to you. Because I enjoy it that much. So I hope you come back next month. And have another awesome conversation. So.
Okay.
All right, sir. We'll talk to you soon. Thank you very much.
Okay, take care. Bye-bye, everybody.
All right, bye-bye. All right, Johnny.
Yep.
This is you and I. So, remember last week I put the lights up? It didn't really look too good.
That.
It didn't really look too good today. Because I didn't have time to set it up properly. So it just kind of looks like I have like insanely white makeup on my face.
Yeah, just don't look. Don't look to your left. It's a bad plan.
So that was kind of a mistake with the lighting. The problem is
my gosh, my face is huge.
I need to get a light that goes in front of me. It would be all right.
Or
kind of bizarre today, but some ways that maybe that's better.
You could just wear some powder makeup to get rid of the glare.
Yes, there you go. Put makeup all over my face before I do a podcast. Makes a lot of sense.
It does.
So that's gonna wrap us up, man. We'll be back next week. What's going on next week? Anything right now, or we don't know?
Next week.
We got all the comments and some of the topics we didn't get to today because we're jam packed with stuff.
Oh yeah, I got comment. I have my little file in my phone of things that when I come up with it.
We're gonna get to the calls. We didn't do any calls today. We'll get back to some calls next week, and I think we're filming this weekend, so I'm sure there'll be some kind of insane thing that happens as always. And,
we'll have some tales. Oh, we'll have some tales, and I'm not talking about Sonic's friend in the airplane.
You're a strange man. A strange, strange man, John. So that's going to wrap us up. So for Ed, for OJ, this is John signing off. You're staring right into my soul. You freaking weirdo. Thank you for listening and being a part of John Presents, the very best in free natural entertainment. I feel creeped out. I feel dirty. I feel disgusted. My friends, we'll talk to you soon. Thanks for checking us out tonight. Bye-bye.